The most rewarding thing about the creative process is that it's really hard. It's so elusive. You just don't know when it's going to strike. And that's the great thing about it. That's the part that I love, that it's you just keep chasing it, and it's, you know, it's like a good healthy drug. When I started in the music business, I got a young start. I grew up in LA, and at the time it was a very, very cool thing to be a studio musician. You know, I was just playing with all the greatest rhythm sections from around the world, essentially. And that capacity I had, that training as a studio musician, has stayed with me forever. I loved composing, I loved arranging, I loved producing, and I loved playing the guitar. And I think those four things helped give me sort of the Lee Ritenour sound. This album, The Twist of Rit, you know, I had a chance to not only write new material for this album, but I decided to go back and just look at my catalog, which spans, you know, over 40 years now. It was really a fun way to approach it. We did fresh arrangements, we flipped and twisted these tunes, and we picked tunes that we thought were relevant for 2015. Rewarding parts of A Twist of Rit for me is the fact that these tunes stand up, and some of them are 40 years old. And so, because that was, I went into this going, oh God, is this stuff going to sound really corny? You know, is it going to be like completely 100% dated? But we picked the right tunes, we twisted and flipped them the right way, and I put a combination of young players together with seasoned players, and I'm happy to say it. Sounds pretty cool. I learned this from Quincy Jones. Casting, it's just like casting for a movie. Casting for a record is very similar. You know, you have to decide what kind of record you're doing, what kind of track you're doing, what kind of arrangement you're doing, what specific sound you want from the other players. I told Dave Grusin, my best buddy for the last 40 years, and I've seen Dave do everything in the studios, and one of the things he was great at was always being the utility guy. He could play piano, he could play Fender Rhodes, clavinet, Wurlitzer, Mini Moog, B3 organ, whatever it called for on the keyboard, he could come up with the right color, the right orchestration. I cast somebody like Ron Bruner Jr., who's kind of like one of the hot young blood drummers out there, the same with Chris Coleman. So I cast them as the ones to add the extra young energy on the drums. And I wanted a horn section this time that I didn't want the stuff played perfectly, kind of more of a 70s kind of vibe, the guys who knew how to kind of fall behind the beat and phrase a little different. And John Beasley, who co-produced some of the record with me, and John was very instrumental in helping out on the record. Probably the latest tune from the old era that's on the album. It was originally done in the middle 90s, and it has a great melodic hook. It was more of a smooth jazz vehicle at the time. We had this idea to kind of put more of a Chris Dave, Robert Glasper, D'Angelo kind of groove on behind the song, and Ron Bruner Jr. just put a real nasty groove on the tune, and we sweetened it with just flugelhorn and flute, and John Beasley playing Rhodes on it, and Dave Grusin playing great mini Moog like he used to do for Quincy Jones in the early days. And so it's got all the right colors, and I kind of got a unique jazz guitar sound, added some very subtle but cool little effects behind the tone. So that one came off real nice. Fans probably know that I keep moving around. I'm kind of a moving target, and I like it that way because, I've made close to 45 albums now, and I still get excited about making albums. And I still get excited about playing the guitar and going on stage and playing. And that's because I love so many different kinds of music. And it's going to be really fun to play this new record.